missionary walks through Vasa Lane, through a clear as crystal Gothenburg morning, removing his suit jacket, loosening his tie, wiping the sweat from his neck and the sleep from his eye. It's 1997, the last morning of August. At the corner of 7-Eleven, he hears the broadcast. Another saint is lost, Lady Di's returned to stardust. He listens to the tragic news, followed by the top 10 tunes. On the other side of the street, he passes Cafe Java. When no one listens to that crap, both coffee and hair dyed raven black, also sure of everything except one question: what's our mission? What are we here for? Who are we serving? Phones off and introduces himself as Jens. Rippling through the Book of Mormon says it's way too early in
the Majority Report with Sam Cedar. It's time to look in the mirror, America. Do you like what you see?
I keep referring to Obama as the magic Negro.
Do you like what you see now?
Well, suck on this.
It's just a mirror, America.
Shared sacrifice by everybody.
What could it do to you except reflect your image?
I did nothing wrong at the Minneapolis airport.
The Majority Report.
Far more credible to me than PBS.
And Front One.
The Majority Report with Sam Cedar.
If I get the feeling you've been cheated.
It is Thursday, March 9th, 2017. My name is Sam Cedar. This is the four-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, Richard Collenberg, senior fellow at the Century Foundation, on America's needs for public school choice, not private vouchers. Also on the program today, Republicans desperately applying lipstick on their pig, while Breitbart and Bannon have a little fight. Also, CIA trying to assess the damage done from a potential leaker within the CIA. Trump administration fills beachhead positions throughout our government with, I don't really know how to characterize the array of these people. And remember that whole thing about boots on the ground in Syria? Well, we have boots on the ground in Syria now.
Several hundred,
yes, several hundred Marines with artillery headed to the Raqqa fight. And the EPA now sprinting to pollute our country. And Mark Cuban is actually out ahead of most Democrats when it comes to offering alternative health care proposals. And lastly, for the sake of Umar Shami on the web, on the IMs, violent video games do not impact empathy. And Matt is very excited. All this and more on today's program.
Matt's like, I could frankly care less either way.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would say this is probably the slowest news day that we've had in 3 or 4 months. And there's still a ton of stuff to talk about. But it doesn't feel chaotic. Has Donald Trump not been tweeting? Is that what's going on?
Yeah, he's been strangely silent, which is unsettling. That means definitely some things are going to happen pretty soon that are going to be really horrible.
It would be like going outside and it would take you a while to realize, like, there's no wind. Like, none. Like, the it's just not moving.
But it also shows, I mean, how relative it is because, you know, several hundred armed troops in Syria, the stories we'll get to about the EPA. Like,
right.
our barometer of what is a news
Indeed.
Day. Yeah, we've become really desensitized.
Indeed. And this is a danger that I think, obviously, it's an acute one for people like us whose job it is to sort of, not sort of, to be sensitive to the news, make editorial decisions and let you know about it. But it's also really important, I think, that consumers of news try to both, on one hand, I mean, this is the classic psychological dilemma, right? I've got to set up defense mechanisms so I don't have a heart attack every day
right.
when I read the news. But I also don't want to become so desensitized that I'm... not fully conscious of the fact that we're putting several hundred Marines into Syria. I mean, I
yes.
I mean, honestly, like I look at sort of some of the aggregating sites that I look at, and it doesn't. Am I mistaken? Is this the first time we've put Marines in Syria? Or any military personnel?
Well, there have been, as far as I understand, this is definitely a escalation and the first time we've put Marines, but we've definitely had
special
advisors,
ops.
Special ops, intelligence people, and obviously we've flown a lot of missions over there. But no, this is different because clearly they're gearing up to take the fight on the ground to ISIL. Like, okay. That's why they're doing this, and they're either going to do it with... Turkey, which has big logistical challenges, or maybe they'll do it with the Kurds. But this is definitely a new
Seems
thing.
Seems like you'd want to work that out before you get on the ground, but I don't know.
Well, I don't think they do have it worked out because Turkey doesn't have a clear route there and they want to throw the Kurds under the bus. Maybe they have an agreement with Russia. Who knows? Or maybe they're just there. It's not like these people make particularly coherent decisions.
The good news is it's only a couple of hundred. That's a quote. Which I would place probably around 600 to 700.
You know that when we said, what does that mean together this morning, we both simultaneously were like, 600.
Right, three times as many. And there's artillery, which I would take to mean that there's at least artillery.
Right, and by the way, this was another point that you made about the debate about Trump, quote unquote, sort of, you know, waking people up, which is that we are going to become, if this was happening under Obama or Hillary,
oh my God.
We would have Juan Cole on, we'd yep. have a specialist, we'd be like, this is
Without
a really dangerous thing. And I was like, oh, okay, just
Did
some reckless Middle East adventurism. Right. Sounds like traditional U.S. foreign policy
right.
to us.
Exactly. Exactly. I'm not convinced that people are just like, oh, whew, okay, back to normal. Everything's fine. Last night, and I just want to give you a sense of what's going on with this Affordable Care Act, repeal and replace. I, for the life of me, I have not seen an analysis or been able to contemplate one which explains this, other than I think the Republican leadership was just like, we're gonna lose. One way or another, this is not going to be good, and this is the best way to go down. And last night, Paul Ryan was on with Tucker Carlson, who is vying to be perceived as less
is comparing his whiteness to Jorge Ramos. We will go we'll cover that later in the program. But I just want you to, if you're watching this, and if you're not, you could probably hear it in Paul Ryan's voice, and you'll also hear him pretend that this is too complicated for people to understand. Here is Tucker Carlson basically saying, hey, and Mike Konzel has a great piece on this. The problem the Republicans have is they attacked the Affordable Care Act from the left, right? It didn't insure enough people. It was too expensive in terms of premiums. It was too expensive in out-of-pocket costs. And those three things, all critiques from the left. And maybe the critique was like, you're enriching insurance companies. All critiques from the left. The critiques from the right are, we don't believe the government should be in the business of ensuring that people have health care. And everything they're doing to insure it is causing it to be too expensive, and the market can take care of it. That's the argument from the right. But they made an argument from the left, pulling out a health plan that is like sort of from the right. They're trying to split the difference, and all they're getting, I think we said this before, is the worst parts for everybody about the Affordable Care Act, short of course, cutting taxes. Here is Paul Ryan trying to make that play. But look at the look on his face where he's like, man, what can you do?
So, kind of a hard sell to say, yeah, we're going to repeal Obamacare, but we're going to send more money to the people who've already gotten the richest over the last 10 years. I mean, that's what this does, no? I'm not a leftist. It's just that's true.
I'm not that concerned about it because we said we were going to repeal all the Obamacare taxes. This is one of the Obamacare taxes. The other point I'd say is
it's dramatic. Do you remember Donald Trump getting up there when he was talking about how bad Obamacare was? That the first thing that he was talking about, we're going to repeal the Obamacare taxes for people making over $250,000 a year. And
he literally never said
capital
that.
Capital gains taxes. In fact, I think you could not find a single Republican who said that in a public forum short of like in the rotunda to some reporters from, you know, The Hill.
That's what this does, no? I'm not a leftist. It's just that's true.
I'm not that concerned about it because we said we were going to repeal all the Obamacare taxes. This is one of the Obamacare taxes. The other point I'd say is this dramatically helps us toward tax reform. I know it gets a little wonky, but by getting rid of the Obamacare.
Now, here he is saying, like, look, I want to skip that part about I don't want to sit here and brag about cutting taxes on the wealthiest people in the country. What I want to do is pretend that what I'm going to say is too complicated for people to understand because I don't really get it myself. But if I start talking about it and tell you that it's wonky, it's okay for people to tune out. I mean, this is actually a very old, I don't know if he's doing it consciously or not, but it's a dramatic technique. You can have a character do anything as long as other people react to it in a way that the audience is. So when he says this is wonky, he doesn't have to explain it and he doesn't have to make any sense because other people are just going like, oh, I assume I don't get what he's talking about.
But by getting rid of the Obamacare taxes, the next bill up coming up this spring and summer is tax reform. And that means the new tax code that we're proposing, we put this in our Better Way plan too. It's a part of our blueprint. Go online and read that as well. That will not have to overcome those Obamacare taxes, meaning when we have a new replacement tax code to gut and replace this tax code, it won't have to also replace the Obamacare taxes. So right. Getting
pause
rid of
it,
all these taxes.
So the look on Tucker Carlson's face is like, what? How are you saying this? Because all Paul Ryan is saying is we do these tax cuts now, and then when we have tax cuts later, we won't be doing it all at the same time. That way we won't be accused of having too many tax cuts because we're doing some now and we're doing some later.
So replace the Obamacare taxes. So by getting rid of all these taxes, we're lowering the revenue that is taken out of the American economy, out of families, out of businesses for the government. And we think that's really important.
Let me just rephrase what he just said. Not even rephrase. Let me repeat it. We're taking the revenue that is taken out of the economy and out of businesses for the American public. Let's play that again. Because for someone who would just preface, like, this gets wonky, what he just said is the way that someone who doesn't know what he's talking about would articulate it good.
the Obamacare taxes. So by getting rid of all these taxes, we're lowering the revenue that is taken out of the American economy, out of families, out of businesses for the government. And we think that's really important.
That's not revenue, what he's talking about. But you don't take revenue out of the economy. That's like...
Gets a little wonky, Sam.
It's a little bit wonky.
It gets a little wonky in the sense that I'm just going to pontificate and blather and talk nonsense to justify giving rich people more money.
All right.
Tucker Carlson's face, that his thoughtful face, is always extremely confused frat boy.
Exactly.
Face.
Somewhat panicked.
Drives me insane. Well, it's because he's stupid. So.
Meanwhile, I'll tell you what you can take out of something. You can take yourself from taking out of your house or your business to go on errands.
Very smooth transition.
Look, stamps.com. It saves you time. It saves you money. I can mail any letter, any package, just using my computer and a printer. Mailman picks it up.
Oh.
Create your stamps account in minutes online with no equipment to lease and no long-term commitments. They've got a great deal with the post office. The post office loves this too because they sell more stamps this way. Click, print, mail, and you're done. Stamps.com never closes. Unlike the post office, it's not outside of your house or outside of your office. You can print postage for letters and packages at your convenience 24/7. Well, I guess 24/7, 7 days a week. That's redundant, isn't it? No. Yes, 24/7
is seven days a week.
Man.
I have a quibble.
This
with
is
the
a
copy.
Little bit wonky, but it is 24/7, 7 days a week. Stamps.com brings all the services of the U.S. Postal Service right to your fingertips. They'll send you a digital scale, automatically calculate your exact postage. Stamps.com will even help you decide the best class of mail based upon your needs. So, for instance, Michael, you'd always have. Low class. I had
what?
Dinner.
What?
I was just hanging out there. I had to do that. Stamps.com, because right now, you can enjoy the Stamps.com service with a special offer that includes a 4-week trial plus postage and a digital scale without long-term commitments. Go to Stamps.com, click on the microphone at the top of the homepage, type in my code Majority Report. That's Stamps.com. Enter Majority Report. Stamps.com. You'll never have to leave your home and go to the post office again. All right, going to take a quick break. When we come back, Richard Kahlenberg.
Can I sit next to you? Can you sit next to me? Get the stars out your eyes. Come and bring them to me. I've been gone so long. I've been working on a plan, yeah. It's just that I've been down so long. I gotta give me my work. Can I sit next to you? Can you sit next to me? Oh. I walk to Memphis alone, 'cause you do it for me. I know you would. All the kicks from the sticks, all the kicks are renewed. I put all that aside, concentrate on you. All the kicks from the sticks.
We are back. Sam Seder on the Majority Report on the phone. It's a pleasure to welcome back to the program senior fellow at the Century Foundation, Richard Kahlenberg, on his piece, America Needs Public School Choice, Not Private School Vouchers. Richard, welcome back to the program.
Oh, well, thanks for having me, Sam.
So Betsy DeVos, our new Secretary of Education, has really made a career, and I think, you know, there's not a lack of quotes from her throughout the years that indicate that her agenda really is... contrary to the idea of public schools. Like she has said explicitly, I believe in public education, but that doesn't mean I believe in public schools. That leads us to this moment, doesn't it?
Yeah, and for those of your listeners who followed the confirmation hearings of Betsy DeVos, that was very clear that she knew very, very little about public schools. She's single-minded in her focus on privatizing our system of education. So it's really really troubling to me.
To be fair, she also seemed to know very little about education as a field, because I think the other thing that we've seen consistently throughout the years is that when she talks about privatizing schools, one of the big agendas is to privatize it towards parochial schools. And I think from her perspective, some form of Christian schools. She sees education as a function of enhancing one's religion, I think. I mean, I don't think I'm...
Yeah.
I think that's a fair statement, isn't it?
I think that's right. That's what the record shows. In this country, anyone has the right to use their own money to send their kids to private school, a religious school. That's in the Constitution. That's part of their freedom of religion. But what she's asking for now is something very, very different, which is using public funds to support private schools, 80% of which are religious in orientation in this country. And that's, I think, that's enormously problematic. You know, the public schools have served us well in trying to promote our democracy, democratic values. And, the purpose of private religious school is to instill a love of God. It's a very different mission than the public schools.
Give me your sense, and I know this is slightly off topic, but it's I think it's relevant when in terms of the arguments that we hear. And I think she's obviously not getting going to give a press conference tomorrow saying like, look, my real agenda here, I want to be really explicit, is to fund predominantly Christian education in this country through tax dollars. And so there's a mountain of rhetorical, I guess, rhetoric that tries to promote the idea of school vouchers. I mean, just what do you make of the criticism that public schools are failing and cannot succeed?
Yeah. Well, I mean, there are thousands and thousands of public schools that are succeeding quite well. I think where DeVos has an in with the American public is in suggesting that certain public schools are struggling, and there's evidence to suggest that some are. It tends to be high poverty, segregated schools that research suggests don't provide a good opportunity. But the question is, what do you do with kids who are trapped in schools that aren't doing well? We can try to improve those schools, obviously. But I think there's also another option, which is providing choice within the public school system. So, public schools are much more accountable than private education. And so the idea would be, can we give kids who are stuck in schools that really aren't doing well an opportunity to go to a different public school where the performance is higher and where they're likely to be more economically and racially integrated and more diverse and therefore could do a really good job with students.
All right. That's basically the argument your paper makes. And I want to go through it, but let me just also clarify. And This is, in many respects, a plan B, right? I mean, this is a plan that you propose when you're in a defensive posture, it seems to me, right? I mean, because no matter what, when we talk about the idea of school choice, it's going to require parents who have the social capital, the education themselves, the time and ability to take advantage of and to really sort of lean into the process in a way that is you know, there's a lot of heavy lifting. I mean, I just know that from being a public school parent myself, and knowing that I have access and resources that a lot of parents, just broadly speaking, don't have.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. That if you have kind of a system of public school choice that requires parents to opt in, that doesn't have any particular guidelines in place to ensure fairness, then you're not going to necessarily serve students well. There are places though, like Cambridge, Massachusetts, where they have universal choice. Everyone chooses. Low-income parents, more affluent parents, and there they've gotten some good results. So I guess I disagree in part. I think this isn't just a defensive posture, you know, response to vouchers, but also I think that if choice is really well implemented, that it can promote social mobility and social cohesion in this country. But these are the exception today. It's only in a small number of communities where they have universal choice, so that everyone's involved in the choice process, not just those parents who have the extra access to, you know, social capital, and where there are fairness guidelines in place to ensure that the choice is going to promote the public good, as opposed to just serving the private interests of parents.
I don't want to get too much off on a tangent here, but because we have choice here in Brooklyn, and you know, as far as I can tell, it still leads to a significant amount of segregation, and that you know, one of the problems is that the schools themselves, they want to get kids who inevitably turn out to be the, you know, more affluent kids, because that's going to help their, because, you know, in education, the relationship between poverty and performance in school is about as close to one-to-one, I think, you know, as you can get. Yep. And so the schools want to get I don't know that they articulated themselves to themselves this way, but maybe they do. The more affluent kids, because that means that there's less pressure on them to deliver the test scores from which they're going to get rated, right? Because the kids are going to come in and they're going to start at a baseline that is going to be that is going to guarantee their success on the other end of the thing.
That's right. That's the logic of just kind of completely unregulated choice, where it often leads to greater levels of segregation, precisely because of the reasons you cited, that the most affluent parents tend to have the most access to information. And then furthermore, schools have an incentive built into the system to want to attract kind of the kids who are most likely to perform well on tests. So unregulated choice is can lead to very, very negative results, but there are some models out there where choice can be used as an engine for school integration by race and by socioeconomic status, where they have weighted lotteries to make sure that everyone's going to benefit. Mm. I'm not saying that's what Betsy DeVos wants,
right.
But there are some positive models out there. So I don't want to shut the door on school choice entirely.
And we should say, in those models you're talking about, you don't need added funds. In other words, like, you know, we even if we have the ability to impose those regulations on private schools, the fact is that it's, for some people, it may be paying tuition. For others, it's just a subsidy to pay a tuition that's five or six times that. Right.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so
that's right.
All right. Well, so let's talk about this idea of diverting scarce funds. Trump ran on a $20 billion school voucher plan. Tell us about that and the implications of it.
Yeah. And there are a couple of different versions. So during the campaign, candidate Trump talked about using $20 billion in federal funds to allow states to promote choice in education you know, including for private schools. So a private school voucher plan. Now, he didn't say exactly how he would pay for it, but people fear that, you know, he's not likely to raise taxes on people in order to get this additional money. And so he's probably going to pull it from, you know, existing funds that are used to promote achievement for low-income kids in public schools. So that would be hugely problematic. There's a lot of research to suggest that money well spent in public education can have a big impact on academic achievement. I mean, you don't need a million studies. Most parents know that already. And so this would divert funds from the public schools to the private schools. The latest iteration, now that he's President Trump, is a twist on this, where they may provide for a system where you would put up to $20 billion in tax credits for families to use private schools. So it's basically like a backdoor voucher program. It's just there's some political advantage to it. When it's a tax credit rather than a voucher, the public doesn't fully understand what's going on. And as a technical matter, kind of in the U.S. Senate, if this goes through the tax credit, then it's possible to do this with just 51 votes in the Senate. So that's why
is this a refundable or non-refundable tax credit?
I think they're talking about a refundable tax credit. So this would be, you know, it would help some disadvantaged students. That's, you know, in order to make this at all plausible, they have to make sure that they're benefiting disadvantaged students. But it'll have the effect of really starving the public schools of the resources that they need.
So just to be clear for folks, what that would mean in practice is that and there's really no way, right, to know what the breakdown of people who would take the advantage of this is. So for instance, it could be 20% of people who are in schools that are failing, and it gives them the opportunity, and as it's a refundable tax credit, it would actually be a payment from the government to low-income people. But right. The other 80% could very well be people who are like, I was going to send my kid to this anyways, and now it's just cheaper for me. Right.
Right. So we don't know the details of what they're planning exactly, but that's one risk. And under a number of the state tax credit programs, they allow corporations to also pay into these programs, get a tax credit, and therefore, you know, reduce their taxes. So quite wealthy corporations can be part of this scheme as well.
And we just explain how it works. I mean, how it actually impacts the public schools, because I don't think people understand the implications of a school that loses, 10, 20%, 30% of its federal funding, 50, 60% of its federal funding, what it does to that school.
Yeah. Well, public school systems will face some very, very difficult choices. So they could increase class sizes significantly as a way of trying to accommodate the fact that they are not going to have the same set of funds to educate students. They could cut after school programs or music programs. There are a number of bad choices that schools will have to make if they have less revenue coming in.
And then just discuss the implications of our tax dollars going to a school system over which we have, I mean, you know, the irony is that the decisions are supposed to be from the local school boards, but in this instance, the decisions would be in the hands of one or two people who are running some type of either for-profit enterprise or are just, you know, I guess an official in a church.
Yeah, that's right. So the private schools ultimately are the ones given choice. I mean, it's talked about as choice for the parents, choice for the children, but a lot of private schools are going to have, you know, very particular ideas about which students they want to participate. In the report that I wrote recently, I cite the work of a colleague of mine, Kimberly Quick, who did some digging into a private school voucher program in North Carolina. And there was one school, the Fayetteville Christian School, that was quite explicit about who would be allowed in and who wouldn't. Now, this is a Christian school, so as one can imagine, you know, they are going to be advocating a certain religion. But at the same time, what they do in their admissions handbook is they're quite explicit about, we don't want Muslims, we don't want Jews, we don't want Hindus, we don't want either even, you know, certain brands of Christianity, like Mormonism, that where they say, we don't want these students. We don't want students whose parents are gay or lesbian, or who themselves are gay and lesbian. So, I mean, it's we lose all accountability when and civil rights protections when we go down this privatization route.
And just to be fair, it actually, I think it says non-messianic Jews.
Okay, right.
So the Jews for Jesus, those guys can get in.
Yes.
Right. But not the non-messianic ones. I mean, that's right. very Christian of them. It cuts against trying to desegregate students by race and socioeconomic status. But what about the massive evidence of success in terms of what private schools produce?
Yeah, that's what's really astounding here, is that Trump and DeVos have gotten behind an idea that the most recent research suggests would be disastrous educationally for kids. So for a number of years, there were studies of private school voucher programs in Milwaukee and Cleveland and other places, and the results were pretty much mixed. I mean, there were they weren't terrible. They certainly didn't improve academic achievement. But in the last couple of years, as these voucher programs have grown, the latest research is really devastating. So you see not just that the students in voucher programs are doing no better, they're doing much, much worse. So there was a study of the Louisiana voucher program, which saw substantial drops in student achievement. The same is true in places like Ohio and Indiana. So this, you know, if we're worried about competing with other countries, this is one of the last things we would want to do, is invest in unaccountable private schools that are actually reducing the achievement of students.
And I mean, this is, it doesn't take much. I don't want to be flip about it, but it doesn't take much effort, it seems to me, to understand why that's the case, right? Because most of these schools are parochial schools, and their value system is such that teaching kids what we, and by we, I mean you and I, and perhaps most of the people listening to this, perceive as educational values are actually lower on the list of priorities.
Right. Yeah. That's, and I think particularly today, when our democracy is under so much stress, you know, with a president attacking the freedom of the press, freedom of religion, you know, these things that had strong bipartisan support in the past, now that our democracy is in stress, we, you know, this would be exactly the wrong moment to divert money to private schools who do not have as their mission the promotion of democratic values. There was a recent study that looked at how young people view democracy, and there was a disturbing uptick in the number of young people who say democracy is either a bad or very bad system, a bad way of running a society. It's now up to about a quarter who are saying this. So, you know, public schools have not always done the best job. They could do a better job of promoting democratic values, but it would be really risky to start diverting money to private schools that have no specific mission of promoting these democratic values and belief in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights.
Yeah, and no, and probably, you know, not as I guess an intense dedication to things like reading and math.
Right.
And science in particular. All right, so let me ask you this. So the who do you hope reads this? Because we were just talking before you came on, we were just briefly touching on this this concept of the Republican rollout of their repeal and replace, and that they have a problem in that they attacked the Affordable Care Act from the left, when in fact they have no interest in doing 90% of what they said they wanted to do to fix the Affordable Care Act. I mean, fundamentally, their perspective is they want to not have the government in the business of ensuring that people are covered with health insurance or to get access to health insurance. I mean, Betsy DeVos, I think, has been, like I say, fairly explicit, far more explicit than one would ever imagine could get her to be confirmed to be Secretary of Education,
right,
about what her agenda is. Who this argument that you're making seems to me to be reasonable, but it is founded on an assumption that we all have the same agenda in providing the best education for as many children as possible. And by best education, we define that as in, you know, understanding and being able to work with science and math and having good literacy skills and the love of learning and perhaps math and, I mean, art and whatnot. And I don't think that set of assumptions is shared with a vast majority, not majority, but a vast number of people in this country. So who is this? Who do you hope reads this and in some way slows Betsy DeVos's role?
Well, I think there was some evidence in the confirmation battle over Betsy DeVos that at least there are some moderate or Republicans who are still supportive of public education. I mean, there are conservative reasons to be supportive of public education as well. If we don't want to do something risky that will reduce academic achievement and further endanger our democracy. So, even in places like Utah, when the private school voucher issue came up, voters defeated the effort. So very, very conservative places, you've seen support for public education. So I've got some hope that there continues to be a strong group of folks, some of whom may have voted for Donald Trump, who nevertheless believe in public schools. 90% of American students still attend public schools. And so there's a vast constituency for improving those schools rather than giving up on them. So I've got some hope that there will be moderates or even conservatives who voted for Trump who nevertheless will support the idea that we need to strengthen our public education system that serves the vast majority of students in this country.
If people want to dig a little deeper and find out those the structures of those school choice programs that you you mentioned, Cambridge, Mass, other places around the country, the good. Where would best place for people to start?
Yeah, well, our report has a lot of links to research on different places that are promoting school choice in the right way, through public schools and in order to promote equity rather than further separation. So our website at the Century Foundation is tcf.org, and on there you can find This new report called America Needs Public School Choice, Not Private School Vouchers, and lots of other reports that my colleagues and I have written over the years that talk about the importance of public education and the need to strengthen it rather than abandon it.
All right, and we'll put a link to that at majority.fm. Thanks so much for your time today. Richard Kahlenberg, Senior Fellow at the Century Foundation.
Very good. Thank you for having me, Sam. Appreciate it.
All right, folks, going to head into the fun half of the program, wherein we will have some fun. We're going to play some video clips. Maybe. We got really slammed on Twitter yesterday for not having any Gorka on
yes,
the show.
Yes, there was a lot of upset about that, so we'll correct that.
We are going to
move on the second half very heavily.
We don't have Gorka today.
We have no Gorka. But we have a new favorite guy in the...
Oh, my God. This is the best thing ever. Best thing ever.
Representative Jason Smith from Missouri.
Every time I try to not do a certain impression, they pull me back in.
He's something else, this guy. You know, I'm always... One of the things I enjoy more than anything else, I mean, it also drives me crazy, is to find the intersection of someone so dumb, but simultaneously so convinced.
So arrogant.
The assessment of themselves is through the moon.
He definitely did one of those. Why doesn't everybody just sit back and learn?
Exactly.
All right, now I'm about to say something truly mind-expandingly stupid.
Folks, it's your membership that makes this show possible. You can become a member today at jointhemajorityreport.com. That's jointhemajorityreport.com. If you want to support the show in other ways, beyond telling your friends about the program or giving us a review on iTunes, which helps, you can buy all your crap through our Amazon or Jet.com links by going to majorityreportkickback.com. I should say, if you buy your crap from Amazon, then buy it through our link. It's the least you can do. You can skim off of Jeff Bezos's profits. Head over to Jet.com, too. They have that still, I think, that 15% off the first three purchases. But you go to majorityreportkickback.com, either click on Jet or click on Amazon, whichever one you use. You should try Jet out, too. And bookmark it. Always go through there. We get a kickback. And, of course, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY. Get 10% off your coffee. Great outfit in Wisconsin. Quick break. We'll be back. 646-257-3920. Tomorrow, I believe, sometimes he disappears on me a little bit. Stephen Elliott, long time listeners will know who Stephen Elliott is. The Rumpus, he wrote that movie with that guy who looks with Franco, that James Franco was in. Very interesting, funny guy. Sort of like a McSweeney's-ish guy. I think he probably...
Oh, I like that. That sounds good.
Yeah,
whatever happened, wasn't there a guy who used to write for McSweeney's who did basically like his blog was just a giant Andrew Sullivan impression? Do you know what I'm talking about? I think his name was like Neil Pollock or something. He was funny.
Oh, Neil Pollock.
I think that was his... I don't think that was his real...
No, Neil Pollock was a guy from... I think maybe he was a McSweeney's, but he was around before that.
Oh, okay. I don't know. I'll look it up.
All right, folks.
Are they still around? McSweeney's?
I haven't heard much about them lately. Like for like the past 5 years. I don't know, maybe. Oh, they are.
We're going to go into the fun half. We're going to move on it very heavily.
We'll be right back after this. It's the fun half, ladies and gentlemen. I want to continue with this theme of offering policies that are consistent with a progressive value system, that are both defensive, a response to Trump's policies, but actually are in and of themselves good policies. Because we have a problem with the Democratic Party at this point. And it's also just a problem with our politics in general. And this is, you know, one of the things that we had spoken about as to why it would be so horrible to have a, never mind Donald Trump, but just a Republican administration, is because so much of what goes on in terms of our politics ends up being just a generic resistance, as opposed to one that is tied into a set of policies or ideas. You don't have to get too granular with these things. Just a broad-based response to the complaints from the population that supposedly the Trump administration is responding to have a Democratic Party, or really just a movement that has its own set of ideas that are a better response to those complaints. And I had mentioned earlier that Mike Konzel had written a piece saying that, you know, the problem that the Republicans have is that they actually campaigned by critiquing the Affordable Care Act from the left, saying that it was too expensive, that premiums were too much, that it was just enriching insurance companies. And the problem they have is that, of course, their proposal actually does all of those things, but even worse. Because they can't be honest with the American public. They can't go out to the American public and say, look, our perspective on health insurance is that's your job, not the government's job. And what we really don't like about the Affordable Care Act is that it gets the government involved and invested in trying to make sure that everyone has health insurance, and it requires taxes on rich people. That would be the legitimate Republican critique of the Affordable Care Act, because that's actually what their critique is. You can hear them say that occasionally, but they can't sell this to the American public. Even when Rand Paul gets out there and tries to say it to the American public, it has to be more about the fantastical notions. If you sell insurance across state lines, all these problems are going to go away. Well, of course, they're not going to. But the failure of Democrats, now, of course, Bernie Sanders is out there saying single payer. Do I think that every Democrat has to say single payer? Well, I'd like them to. But they have to say something.
I would say at a bare minimum public option.
Well,
they have to explain.
Yeah, of course they do. But I'm just saying, my critique is not that I don't like their policy. My critique is they don't have a policy that they're offering the American public. And Protect ACA is still,
I mean, that's all they're saying.
Not Protect addressing, ACA. It's not addressing
right.
any of the complaints that the Republicans have gotten elected on.
That's right.
Which are complaints from the left. So I'm not even in the mode right now where I'm judging the pluses and minuses of any policies that they're offering. I'm saying they're not offering one that addresses any concerns. And it's brought into stark relief by the fact that Mark Cuban, apparently in between takes on whatever it is, Shark Tank or whatever show that is.
I think it is Shark Tank or whatever that is.
Shark Tank.
That's a cool show.
Okay. But whatever.
That's a cool show.
In between takes on Shark Tank, drew up a basically single payer, as far as I can tell. I mean, it's very broad, but this is all you need. I like it's premised on two premises, that we can lose the genetic lottery and find ourselves getting seriously ill or worse. In other words, we can get cancer. Or we could be in the wrong place, wrong time. We could get hit by a bus. And so basically, his argument is, whether it's Medicaid or Medicare or any other program, every single person in this country should be covered 100% for chronic physical or mental illness and for any life-threatening injury. In other words, basically a single-payer catastrophic insurance for everybody. After X number of dollars that you spend, or covering all non-elective chronic health issues. I don't know. There's no details here. But the concept itself is all that you need to go out and sell. And then you would have private insurance, which would cover extra things. And this is not terribly inconsistent, depending on how generous or not it is, with like places like France or Canada, or even the model of Medicare or Medicare Advantage or Medicare Gap insurance. But the idea that we got to hear this from Mark Cuban, as opposed to Chuck Schumer, is pathetic.
I mean, is this a time to bring up that tweet from the Democrats?
Yeah.
I mean, just the messaging and the way it intersects with how unbelievably failed the policy is. I mean, look at this. This is unbelievable.
This is from the Democrats' Twitter account. Now, I don't know. I mean, I'm not making a fair assessment because I'm not looking at all the other tweets. Maybe they have great tweets. But it's a picture of Paul Ryan looking down. Hospitals, we cannot support the American Health Care Act in its current form. And the tweet is, if the hospitals are coming out against the GOP healthcare proposal, you know it desperately needs revision.
Zing!
No, I know it needs desperate revision because it screws over the vast majority of people in this country. That's how I know it needs revision.
Right.
Not that there are for-profit hospitals that have a problem with it. That's secondary.
Or maybe it just needs to be scrapped and killed. Because it's a terrible
bill. I know it needs revision because it's just a way to give tax cuts to wealthy people. I know it needs revision because it doesn't do anything about premiums or deductibles or out-of-pocket expenses. That it weakens the patient's Bill of Rights. That's how I know it desperately needs revision. It's pathetic. I mean, this isn't even a defensive crouch that they're in.
No. It's an aggressive stupidity. And I'm starting to also see it too with, you know, I think the Russia thing's a completely valid story and worth exploring. But I can understand on the flip side, we get the criticism from the left of like, you're going to create a new Cold War, that nonsense. But on the other hand, you know, Katrina Vandenhoevel put out a tweet saying like, hey, can we start to balance this with coverage of people losing their health care and so on and so forth? And you get responses like, well, if I'm Putin, now I want to kill Americans. What would I do it by? Getting rid of health care?
Well,
just saying no. But
there are morons on Twitter, yes.
No, but the serious point is that the Democrats are failing on this and still paying disproportionate time to this Russia thing.
I think you can walk and chew gum. I mean, if the Russia stuff has salience, that's the problem,
right?
Is that they're walking and they're not chewing gum.
And they're not even walking straight.
Let's not belabor the metaphor too much. But that's the point. The point is, the Democrats need to come out when you're having a policy battle. And it doesn't have to be too intricate because it's not going to get, nobody's going to vote for it. But you need to put this policy into its perspective, in context, as being horrible. You need to put forward another that is better.
So what would that be?
That is, it could be a public option.
Option.
I'm going to say, you could just put together other principles like this. We're going to cover if we have our Affordable Care a bill, which will open public options to everybody and create that competition to drive prices down. It will force private health insurers to stay in the exchanges and thereby driving prices down. I mean, There's a million that between where we are and single payer for all. Personally, I think they should come out, let's just expand Medicare to age 45. And then catastrophic insurance for everybody underneath that. I mean, it doesn't even have to make too much sense from a wonk perspective. It just needs to promote some broad-based values that you can push back on, and they're not doing it.
Why?
Weak.
And is it also because they cannot get
Kelly,
people to call us?
I'm not going to argue that the Democratic Party has absurdly horrible messaging. I mean, it was blowing my mind over and over again for Hillary's entire campaign, and it's just all around terrible. And I mean, I saw that tweet yesterday, and it's just like, what? I mean, what are you thinking? But I think it's the Republican base. The Republicans know that they can message to their base very easily because their messaging is basic and they don't need to be telling the whole truth. And what you just said about it not needing to come from a wonk perspective and not even needing to be like so policy based, I think the Democratic Party really can't get around that because they want it to be true and fully true, and then it gets into that is difficult branding and messaging, and then it comes out all wrong.
I mean,
what you said about, you know, sending, you know, saying this is expanding Medicaid would be something new and different. So that would be great messaging if the Democratic Party was going to get behind that in general. But just saying the other things that you suggested, I mean, it's just setting yourself up to say, well, Obamacare was already failing. I mean, these people.
I think everybody has already made the argument of, I think you can't find a Democrat who won't say that Obamacare is perfect. I mean, at this point, they've all adopted that anyways. So if you've conceded the point that Obamacare is not perfect, why not offer another broad plan?
But that's great. That's what I'm saying. Offer another broad plan, make it basic. That's the problem with Democrats' messaging. They can't be basic.
They could,
because I mean that's the
they could.
Well, they can. They seem
just
to
said,
have an inability to do so. It's like, I mean, this isn't a real comparison, but you know, Sean Spicer with those stacks of paper. I mean, that is how complicated healthcare really is. And they want it to be, you know, this tiny stack of paper that's not real legislation. It's never going to work. It has to get much more complicated. But that's the difference in how how the messaging.
I understand, but it doesn't have to be.
Okay, well.
You can say Medicare for all. That's not even a full page.
I know, but everyone in the Democratic Party isn't behind that.
Well, I mean, they've got to get behind something.
That would be awesome if they did.
But you know
I'm
what?
Just saying,
everybody in the Republican Party turns
that
out not to be behind their thing, too. I mean.
Well, you're correct. Right. But their messaging is often
so
false.
I don't understand what you're saying. You understand why the Democrats have come out with no plan?
I understand why they have a more difficult time getting around coherent messaging because.
Well, I mean, yes, they can't.
These
they
things
have,
are
but
complicated,
but this
and
isn't,
they refuse
this
to
isn't
simplify
that complicated.
Them.
They're compromised by corporate money. They're nerds, and they don't know how to do messaging, and they don't have a coherent platform.
All of those things.
Yes.
All right, let's go to some sound here. Here is Eric Bowling. On
the
Five. And I guess apparently Meghan McCain, is she on the Five now or is she just visiting? And this just expands my point. Eric Bowling pretends that the problem with the conservative Trump care plan is that it doesn't control costs, or as if that's what they care about. No. From conservatives, don't believe that there should be any health insurance. There should be any involvement by governments in insurance. But here he is making that case, again, critiquing Trump care from the left when he doesn't care about that.
Okay.
Can I do this? Can I ask anyone at the table or anyone out there, show me one thing in this bill that reduces the cost of either health care or health insurance?
Doesn't.
Not one? Just show me one. You know what would? Competition. That's the only thing that's going to do it, and there's nothing competitive in here right now. You know who gets the best break in this whole thing? Not the American people, not the middle class, not young people, not old people.
Insurance company.
Insurance company. Yeah. $100 billion carve out over 10 years to the insurance company.
You know,
guys, Republicans, conservatives, we've spoken, we've talked, we've voted, we've run on exactly opposite principles of this. Okay. The exact opposite of this. They need.
All right. So here's his complaint. The only thing that's going to help drive down costs of health insurance and health care is competition. And I guess theoretically this is allow insurance companies to sell across state lines. But we already have this in like three or four states around the country, and we've seen insurance companies are not interested in doing that. They are perfectly willing to stay in their markets that they've established and make their money that way. And the idea that I'm going to, when I get hit by a bus, on the way in the ambulance, I'm going to go, you know what? Wait a second. I've got an app that's going to tell me which hospital you should take me to. I want to go to the one that's 3 hours away, because their costs for bedding and food significantly cheaper. And they've got a 4-star rating on the on their what I anticipate will be the surgery I will need as I lie here in this gurney.
You shouldn't plagiarize the PowerPoint that Paul Ryan is doing right now.
Exactly. Here is Joe Kennedy, the third. Robert Kennedy's grandson. He is a congressman from Massachusetts. I think he's mid-30s. And here he at least is making a moral argument against Paul Ryan's piece.
And taking it to Ryan. That's another distinguishing feature.
Indeed.
Chairman, I was struck last night by a comment that I heard made by Speaker Ryan, where he called this repeal bill, quote, an act of mercy. With all due respect to our speaker, he and I must have read different scripture. The one that I read calls on us to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to shelter the homeless, and to comfort the sick. It reminds us that we are judged not by how we treat the powerful, but by how we care for the least among us. Mercy. Defined in purely secular terms, it's compassionate treatment for those in distress. It's kindness, and it is grace. There is no mercy and a system that makes healthcare a luxury. There's no mercy in a country that turns their back on those most in need of protection, the elderly, the poor, the sick, and the suffering. There's no mercy in a cold shoulder to the mentally ill. There's no mercy in a policy that takes for granted the sweat, the tears, and the sacrifice of working Americans that they shed every day so that they might care for their family's basic needs, food, shelter, health, and hope for tomorrow. There's no mercy
for
the 2.6 million people who will lose their job if Obamacare is repealed. This is not
chair,
an act of mercy.
Chair now recognizes gentlelady.
There you go.
An act of malice. That's good. I mean, are they going to follow his lead a bit and finally start putting Paul Ryan on the table? I mean, that was just incredible failure. The Obama reelect is another thing that they did more than any modern Democrats have done, which is put Paul Ryan in play as VP. As soon as he was announced, they said, hey, this is this guy's cruel, you know, Ayn Rand budget. That was a major part of the reelect as well.
Yes. They were not, they did not give him the.
I say, we're going to run ads against Romney, but I think when we win reelection, we'll work with Ryan to slash the social safety net. And you know what's funny is that they might have even been planning on doing that, but they were still smart. to work with Ryan to slash the social safety net, but they were still smart enough to attack him.
Yeah, exactly. It's a total lack of political. I mean, it's political malpractice, and in this instance, I think it's also a function of their at least with the Clinton campaign. I think it was a function of it was an ideological mistake. It was one right. born out of their ideology, which Chuck Schumer also I think shared.
Well, and seems to, I don't know if he's learned the lesson or not, but remember, it was Chuck Schumer's famous quote. He said, for every working class voter we lose in
Philadelphia, we'll get two in the suburbs.
Right. Well, that's their downfall. They're obsessed with suburban women.
Well, I mean, I don't know if it's necessary.
Well, the specific demo of that argument that you would win with Republican suburban voter women specifically were repulsed by Trump was a miscalculation.
Here is this guy's too good. So the House and Ways and Means Committee
yes.
debated yesterday. Presumably, I guess on this bill. Didn't they come out too with they called the bill like the world's greatest healthcare 2017? There's two committees that are marking this up. Ways and Means is one. And I can't remember what the other ones. Maybe it's some.
I think it's energy for some reason.
And part of that, I think, has to do with the fact that this is going to be a reconciliation project. And so this legislation is going to be passed through reconciliation, which I think maybe only specific committees have access to because it affects the budget. I'm not sure. But here is Missouri Representative Jason Smith. And there's two ways to look at what he's doing here. One way to look at it is he's doing a performance piece called The Dumbest Thing I Can Say, but doing it in a way that makes me think I'm the smartest man in the room. The other way in which you could perceive this is he's just doing some good Republican politicking.
You know, there's a lot of taxes out there, but you could tax a lot of different items if you want to stop behavior. You know, I love ice cream.
Michael!
Ice cream's probably not the most healthy thing to eat. Probably. Why is there not a tax on that? You know what? If you look at the number one cause of skin cancer, it's not tanning beds. Do a Google search. It's the sun. So I noticed the people over here haven't found too many taxes that they dislike. So why have they not proposed a tax on the sun?
Let's work backwards to front, shall we? I suspect a
that guy's
major
making
reason
a lot of sense.
Why you wouldn't tax the sun is because it's impossible to tax the sun. Now, you could say tax something like hydrocarbons and other energy sources, particularly ones that impose a cost on the rest of society. Since society's going to have to bear that cost, then the taxes would be appropriate. But that's not really what he's talking about.
You think you're so smart. Maybe you should Google something.
And as far as taxing ice cream, not such a crazy idea, actually. Just for example, we have, I think, a half a dozen cities in this country.
Are you about to throw Mike Bloomberg some props here?
We have a half a dozen cities in this country that have a tax on sugar-sweetened drinks. There was a study just, I don't know, less than a year ago out of Australia. A 20% tax on sugar-sweetened drinks would result in widespread, long-lasting public health benefits and significant health cost savings, a new study shows. Now, health cost savings is important because that's borne by everybody who pays taxes. And when you pay taxes to take care of people on diabetes, you are subsidizing their drinking sweetened drinks. And you're subsidizing the makers of those sweetened drinks, who are basically offloading the cost of their product, of their profits, on all of us. We found, according to this, not only the tax obviously raised $400 million a year, whatever, we found there would be over 800 fewer new type 2 diabetes cases each year. After 25 years, about 1,600 fewer deaths. This is in Australia, folks, with a population, I think, maybe, a tenth of ours, a fifth of ours, quarter of ours. A sixth, a seventh. There would be 4,400 fewer people with heart disease at the time and 1,100 fewer people living with the consequences of stroke. In effect, Australians would enjoy about 170,000 healthy life years that they would not have otherwise. I think Mr. Smith should go back to the drawing board and start thinking about proposing this ice cream tax.
Yeah. Maybe if you didn't hate terrorists so much, we could tax ISIS.
Here he is.
You love terrorists, so we can't.
Now, but look. It's one thing to make fun of this congressman from Missouri, Representative Jason Smith, because he makes a dumb comment about taxing the sun and a dumb comment about taxing ice cream.
Gets better.
But why do that when you can make fun of him for wondering why on International Women's Day people don't contemplate the implications of taxing tanning beds?
And what I found on Google is roughly 80% of who's taxed are women. So out of the $600 million that has been created by this tax, which is an interesting excise tax, $480 million has come from the backs and the pockets of women. Today's International Women Day. It's interesting that no one is bringing that up.
I mean, think about it. Kind of blows your mind, doesn't it?
And I haven't even given the international costs of taxation of tanning beds throughout the world.
Maybe my colleagues on the other side of the aisle would like to tax tanning beds in Ukraine. Maybe everywhere. Maybe women who want to not look gross and pale.
I just find
they should all just pay for everything.
I just think it's interesting. That's all. I'm talking slowly so that it'll sink into your mind that I Googled this.
I Googled this, and it's just interesting to me that a lot of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle think that black people are full humans. You can Google that. There's a lot of things you can Google. It's called Martin Luther King Jr. Facts.org.
I really do love somebody who can go up there and put on airs of being that smart while saying something so dumb.
Yeah, that guy is really feeling himself like he's the new Thomas Paine and like just cutting right through.
If
all
you're
the
not, if you're only listening to this, but if you should really watch it on YouTube because it's not. I mean, he obviously sounds ludicrous enough in terms of what he's saying.
So self-satisfied.
But he is literally like scanning the room, like I know you guys aren't going to have a response.
Who here amongst us has Googled? Speaking of Google, let's put a Google alert on that guy.
I just did a Google search on him to see what his other positions are on things, which are all terrible. And that the tanning beds thing is already on his Wikipedia page as like one of the main entries.
That's too bad. I wish there was a whole nother like just world of stuff from that guy. We spoke yesterday in part, and we've been Scott Pruitt, who has been named the and confirmed as the EPA chief administrator, was a guy who came from Oklahoma who was so in bed with the oil and fracking industry that the head of an oil fracking outfit, a guy named Ham, I think it's Harold Ham, was his 2014 reelect co-chair as Oklahoma AG. And this guy has, I think, still 14 pending suits against the EPA to prevent the EPA from doing its work. We talked yesterday about how the Office of Science in the EPA has removed the word science from their website, but more importantly, has changed the mission of the EPA from protecting our environment to attempting to protect our environment, but making sure we don't cost corporations any money. That's the fundamental change that has happened with the EPA. Here he is on Squawk Box, and frankly, the whole interview with the Squawk Box thing was just nauseating. From the whoever that dude is that hosts Squawk Box, throughout the entire, yeah, whoever that guy is, he's just horrible. And this is CNBC, where all they care about is how quickly, how fast, how fundamentally will you be rolling back all of these things that the EPA does. And Pruitt basically very calmly says, well, we're going to be methodical about it. But here he is.
I believe that.
Here he is, the head of the Environmental Protection Agency, talking about what is not the primary contributor to global warming. And here's a hint. He's not going to say man.
Well, so, let me ask you one other thing, just to get to the nitty-gritty. Do you believe that it's been proven that CO2 is the primary control knob for climate? Do you believe that?
No, I think that measuring with precision human activity on the climate is something very challenging to do, and there's tremendous disagreement about the degree of impact. So no, I would not agree that it's a primary contributor to the global warming that we see.
Okay.
All right. But we don't know that yet. As far as we need to continue the debate and to continue the review and the analysis.
I agree. When I hear the science is settled, it's like I never heard that science actually gotten to a point where it was. So that's the whole point of science, is that you keep asking questions. But I don't want to be called a denier. So, scares me. It's a terrible thing to be called. Anyway, Administrator Pruitt, I know you don't want to be called that either. Thanks for being with us this morning. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Do they need a safe space?
Can we go back? Can we go back to this? I want you to watch this again.
Do they need a safe space?
Yeah. This is really, I mean, is he asking if CO2 or man-made CO2? Like, they're so lost in this conversation. This is the guy who is the head of the Environmental Protection Agency being, I wouldn't even say, interviewed on CNBC. I would say cupped is really the only thing I could express this. Let's listen to this again, because it bears repeating. This is so insane.
Control knob for climate. Do you believe that?
No, I think that measuring with precision human activity on the climate is something very challenging to do, and there's tremendous disagreement about the degree of impact.
Stop it. So he asks, is CO2 the control knob on climate? Which is just a bizarre question to ask. Global warming is primarily a function of too much carbon dioxide. Pruitt assumes he means man-made creation of CO2. I think. And I think like Pruitt gets thrown off, like, oh, this isn't the way you're supposed to ask this question.
Yeah. That's what it is. No, I think because there's the sort of, that's the pseudo-sophisticated way of casting doubt on the science.
He dropped the man-made part in his question.
Right.
And Pruitt was like, wait, no, that's, and then so watch where they go with this. Yeah. And then the guy basically just at the end says, hey, I'm sorry, I botched the question. But the bottom line is neither one of us are deniers, right?
Also, just look at where Pruitt happens to be.
Where is that? Is he
he's in
a,
Houston?
In it, I would imagine he's at like some type of like an energy summit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So no, I would not agree that it's a primary contributor to the global warming that we see.
Okay.
All right. But we don't know that yet. As far as we need to continue the debate and to continue the review and the analysis.
All right, pause it. So he says, so despite the question he was asked, which is CO2 the primary knob of global climate, he answers a different question, which is, I would not agree that man-made CO2 production is is the primary cause of global warming. And then he says, but we don't know that. So he knows it enough to disagree with it, but he doesn't know it enough to not, I mean, this is, you know, I don't even know, like,
better.
On some level, I feel like, you know, like, why do we even break it down this much? They're liars. They don't care.
That's the bottom
they
line.
They don't have the guts to say what they believe. And they just lie. And there's two people lying to each other. And there's, I don't know, how many people watch any given CNBC show? Another 15,000 who are sitting there all just nodding each other. Like, oh, good. We're all lying with each other. As long as we're on the same page. You keep going.
I agree. When I hear the science is settled, it's like I never heard that science actually gotten to a point where it was. That's the whole point of science, is that you keep asking questions, you keep asking questions. But I don't want to be called a denier, so you know, it scares me. It's a terrible thing to be called. Anyway, Administrator Pruitt, I know you don't want to be called that either. Thanks for being with us this morning. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
And then let's just cut away. Like, they can't cut away from that segment quick enough so that they end up landing on a on another co-anchor. Just sort
it's
of
just it's fucking intellectual exploration. Am I right, Scott? I don't like to be called close-minded.
That was just unbelievable. These guys.
That is an amazing tick of
CNBC.
These people, right? That they like. They do have their weird, bizarre own desire for their own like safe spaces.
Oh yeah,
that's like
those.
That's.
Let me make it clear how aggrieved I am that I can actually my whatever it is $500,000 to $1 million a year. To who knows how much that guy gets paid, but then I have to actually go outside and have some people say that.
I'm just gonna like, and also just have complete disregard.
I'm not a climate denier. I'm a science inquisition promoter.
You would need to use slightly smaller words, but I like the direction.
I'm a science asking questioner promoter.
The great thing about
a science asking question promoter. Let's book you on the Rubin Report.
Thank
you. The great thing about science is you never have to draw any conclusions about anything.
Right. I even Tom Carper, who is like the quintessential problem with Democrats. I just tweeted at you, Matt. He actually quote tweeted that clip and wrote, I think 97% of the world scientists were surprised to learn this today. I know I was.
These people don't have a strange need for safe spaces. Everything that's happening is white dudes' desire to make this country a safe space for them again.
What we
they
need
feel
is
so
we need
threatened.
A safe space because when the Jews come in, I get very triggered.
A safe space for white dudes because it's so dangerous for them right now. So scary.
Well, I never thought of it that way before. I'm going to give these guys a look.
Kidding me?
Let's go to the phone.
I feel safer.
Calling from a 727 area code. Who's this?
You shouldn't feel safe.
727.
I'm on the wrong side of that.
For Florida.
Who's this?
Hi. Anthony. From Florida.
Hi, Anthony. What's on your mind?
I wanted to go back to a conversation you guys were having a couple of weeks ago about movies, specifically, like you were having sort of an internal debate about whether you wanted to see movies that were more politically relevant, or if you wanted to see them more escapist.
Ah, okay.
And. I just wanted to contribute to that conversation. Basically, I used to subscribe to a whole bunch of YouTube channels that were mainly about games, you know, just fun, irrelevant little things. And I found myself after the election just unsubscribing from almost all of them because I couldn't really understand how these people who had a massive platform from which to speak could not say anything about the election as though nothing had happened. Everything was the same. And I sort of feel the same way about movies too, you know? I really want, even the things that I love, like Star Wars, I want them to be more politically relevant to today, to say something, you know?
I feel the same way. Like, it's very weird for me to watch entertainment programs that seem to be completely divorced from what's going on in mm-hmm. the reality of our country. Like, to the point where, like, you know, I think I said this a bunch of times, like, this place where I get the my coffee in the morning, it's like a bodega, and they have, is it Kelly Ripa who does all the guest hosts?
I think it's Kelly Ripa, yes. Yeah. She does, like, the morning show type of thing.
Yeah, and I just look at this, and they're all smiling and these, like, incredibly plastic smiles. I mean, it might freak me out, mm-hmm. but you know, talking about, like, what, here's a great bean dip. And I'm just thinking, like, how can they be so, it feels empty to me. I mean, I think that's a good point. And
did you
see
Moonlight?
You know what's interesting? I listened to Maron's podcast, Mark Maron's, on occasion. Not that often, but occasionally. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because Mark, really the politics became too much for him through Air America. And I can see him struggling, like, you know, on the show for the past couple of months to not bring it up. And, you know, I think to his credit, mm-hmm. I think too, because he just feels compelled. Like, look, I live in the world, and
he cares about stuff. Yes, even if he didn't want to cover it, he's a conscious person.
But I'm saying, like, he made a conscious, like creative editorial decision. Like, I'm not going to do politics, not because he's afraid of the controversy, but just because he was trying to create a certain thing that was not of that. And even with that edict, he can't avoid talking about it because
he made that decision
in the
Obama time.
Right.
It's such a completely different environment.
Right.
Yeah.
Good point. I appreciate the phone call.
Have a good one.
Bye. You too. Calling from a 509 area code. Who might this be?
Zachary Scott.
Oh, hi, Zachary. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from a little town called Omak in north central Washington.
And what is
it? I am not Reagan.
What is on your mind?
Well, do you remember the Politico article on Trump's private security force about a month back?
Yes.
Well, I just finished reading an interesting book called Army of Evil, on the history of the SS, and the beginning of that organization strikes some similarities to the small private security force.
Indeed.
That used as muscle at his.
I don't know if you've heard me tell this story. I don't know if you've heard me tell this story, but and I think that Politico piece was actually from like a couple of months ago now. But I ran into Malcolm Nance at MSNBC, and among other things, I asked him about that, and he said, Secret Service will not let those guys carry guns. He said, whenever I was in special ops, when we were in Iraq, if any individual came and they had Secret Service detail, we immediately stood down. And I said, well, who makes that determination? And he said, the head of Secret Service will go to them and say, give me your guns. You're not carrying guns. And I'm like, well, what leverage does he have? Because can't Trump just say, no, they're keeping their guns? And he said, well, I mean, at that point, yeah, then he would resign. And that conversation I had was shortly after that piece I had seen in Politico. And I believe 3 weeks ago, maybe it was 3.5 weeks ago, the head of the Secret Service resigned and retired. Now, I haven't heard anything since then, but yes, I share your concern.
Old Dad would be very proud of what we're doing.
I share your concern.
Well, can I just real quickly, listeners should definitely read Army of Evil by Adrian Wheel. It's a good kind of ground to how the Nazis came to rise and how and what the SS actually was. And I don't like throwing around the Nazi comparison stuff to Trump, but it is a little bit bizarre and frightening.
Can I just make, we're trying to get him, I'm working on it, but Timothy Schneider, who writes on totalitarianism, and he's a professor at Yale, he has a new book out, but he had this really smart way of saying, like, you're not trying to make a direct comparison to Hitler, obviously, but you're also, you need to have the willingness to point to direct comparisons that open up legitimate lines of thought. Like,
right, there are
dynamics.
There's
a third way here.
There's dynamics.
There's dynamics. And he's saying it becomes its own block to inquiry, though,
yes,
to just be like, we can never make that comparison,
right,
because there's actually other points where it's like, oh,
right,
those are actually valid. Yeah.
Appreciate the call.
Hitler copyrighted all that stuff. That's why you can't mention it.
I can't. It's a Hitler TM.
I'm Jimmy Sullivan. Coincident with the WikiLeaks dump that supports what we've been told about smartphones and TVs capable of spying on us, even if they're turned off. Deep State Community Outreach Ombudsman Michael Hayden appeared on Colbert this week, putting a happy face on our shadow government. He can rightfully deny Trump's assertion only in the narrow context of Obama ordering the wiretap of Trump Tower, but we know from Snowden and Bill Binney that everybody's phone is wiretapped and those recordings exist somewhere. Joseph Ballin, guess Breitbart is looking to lose its special status as propaganda outlet for the White House after attacking Trump Care. We need to divide the right from Trump, make them kill each other. What's your opinion of the odds of Trump attacking North Korea? Because I'm starting to hear talk about this, and it scares the living crap out of me to think we would attack a nuclear power with the largest military on planet. Also, Trump will get a second term unless Democrats run Sanders, Tulsi Gabbard, or Nina Turner. I want a unity ticket of Gabbard Stein 2020, but that only exists in my mind. We aren't falling for Hopi changey BS ever again. Aside from me not being terribly interested in Tulsi Gabbard, I haven't heard much about Trump attacking North Korea. Berthold Mecht. So this morning it broke that a Hotmail account associated with Roger Stone, yes, I've seen this, has a registered account at a literal cuckoldry web forum, and that Cernovich has been trying to get the records of the Epstein Lolita Express cases unsealed to harass the accuser and defend his buddy Dershowitz. It seems that these Trump chuds continually give up the ghost on their own weird sexual paraphilias and sexual pathologies. This does lead me to an important question. So is Gorka a secret self-hating Muslim? Also beta cuck, beta cuck, beta cuck.
All right. Wait, I mean, isn't Stone already established
Stone
to be a swinger for
well
a long
known
time?
Swinger. Yeah. So that's not terribly surprising. The thing I did see at the Smoking Gun is that he may have been in touch with Gussifer, which would be interesting.
But this is ridiculous.
CPW.
It's a connection.
Got into an argument about the national debt and Social Security yesterday that devolved into a fist fight. Is that worth a shofar? No, that's worth two shofars.
Maybe some fanfare, too. I like that. Progressive's getting serious.
In fact.
Yeah. The next time you hear somebody say that Social Security isn't solvent well into the future, you should Richard Spencer that person.
I'm a little banged up, but he's still wrong and stupid. I mean, I'm pretty close to coming to your house and actually blowing an actual shofar.
That would be an incredible majority like report survey. Have you assaulted anybody as a result of a wonk argument? We will literally travel to you.
If we ever do, one of those GoFundMe things again or whatever, which I hope never, ever to do again in my life for anything. But that would be good. But no, I would actually rather do it for, like, we could make it a sort of like a prize for something like that.
This guy kept saying that insurance across state lines would lower costs, so I broke his jaw. We'll be there with the shofar.
Kelly mentioned Tucker Carlson's confused frat boy face. I went to Trinity College in Hartford, Connecticut, around the same time as he. You know what? That's funny because Trinity was one of the colleges I got into when I ended up going to Connecticut College. It was a little bit more of a cuck school. Trinity, the reason why I didn't go to Trinity, was because I had had enough of that in Worcester.
I was cucked so much in high school that I didn't want to be cucked anymore.
It had that quality of like just...
Sam shows up on campus and some like well-fed Connecticut prep boy is just like, hey, you got a girlfriend? Oh, no, I don't want any more of this. I'm going to go to Connecticut College and study art.
No, it just there was just a high quotient of that, like, I don't know. Hockey player type.
Hockey players, you want to take my girlfriends?
He was a member of St. Anthony Hall, which is the most elitist frat on campus. There was no frats at Connecticut College. That's what I liked about that. The standard issue garb for these dorks included a bow tie, which he allowed the ultra-rich brain-dead Hall members to easily identify each other in the dining hall. Should they dare to mix with the plebes, he ditched the tie but held on to the confused frat boy face. Great effing guy. E. Greg, as a consequentialist libertarian, I can tell you that my policy proposals are more progressive than Democrats today. Democrats have become lame, sorry, ever since the party abandoned Bernie. What?
You're managing to fuse so many annoying political tropes in one IM there. It's actually kind of artistic.
I advocate to reduce government to single-payer systems for things 95% of people need. Vouchers for the first X number of dollars for everybody, even in the rich, would get $100 a week in food stamps for all loaded onto their card every week. School food producers, doctors should compete, and buyers should not be competing to see who pays for more of the basics. This
is my
minarchist position. I'd slash the army, abolish minimum wage, everything else. Government should just be a single payer for the basics with minimal regulations, and private market providers should compete for business. Prop doc.
They should use some of these IMs for like interrogating terrorists. They're like, okay, yes, I helped fund the attack to stop with the minimalist state libertarian explanation. Please, I'll give up all context for ISIL funding.
We haven't heard from Greg in months and months.
Greg called while I was hosting.
I know. He called the other day when I called, but he's coming back. Prior to that. In honor of Biggie Smalls, Michael, can you say some Biggie lyrics in different voices, preferably suicidal thoughts in Gorka?
Actually, you know what I thought of the other day? I was listening when where he says in 88 he sold more powder than Johnson & Johnson. I literally was walking on the street and I was like, it's true. I did.
Cucky Cheese. Kelly, the sun will come out tomorrow, not too obvious or subtle. Democrats propose expanding Medicaid. Simple, Jesus, stop tripping over yourselves. Ouch, just stepped on my dick, Michael. JWR official Mandela, you know, I was talking to Joey F and No Socks the other day, and he reminded me that the
guy.
House Negro is still pulling strings. Even Sessions was taken aback when we all went golfing with African Cobalt Cubs. Clubs and the tiny hands asked if he ever had a fucking enter. But Joey told me he wasn't racist and that no one speaks Russian or bathes in Cheeto flavoring.
Oh, okay. Part of that I could decipher is supposedly Don Cheadle.
Yeah, tweeted. I heard that.
Yeah, okay. There it is.
That his father-in-law had golf with Trump, and Trump said, have you ever had sex with an N?
Which, and you know, it really speaks volumes that I saw that and I was like, yep. I believe that.
Epish. The Democratic Party executive leadership problem isn't messaging. They depend on non-labor special interests too much for funding to have distinct values. With no distinct values, the messaging can't help but fail. They need to stand for workers, but the executive leadership refuses to give up power.
I actually kind of think it's two different problems, though, because I think that you did have Democrats and center-left politicians who had terrible policies, but they were like Bill Clinton, Tony Blair, even Howard Dean, not a particularly liberal guy, way better at messaging. So it's it's two different problems in some ways.
George is in Seoul. The Democratic Party needs to just tweet out Springsteen and Bob Marley lyrics coming out of Democrats' mouth in a slightly different wording. That's the way to grab at our heartstrings and pull people back to the light. Cat, Sam, I watched Ways and Means all day yesterday. An Energy Commerce Committee is now in its 27th hour. Dems are throwing amendment after amendment to the pieces they're discussing. Doesn't matter what Dems throw out there, big or small. It's all party line vote in the House, and it's been excruciating to watch so many Republican performance pieces. BB Teach, so climate change isn't scary, but being a denier is amazing. How do they look themselves in the mirror? Colleen, Sam, you mentioned at the top of the show there weren't as many bombshells in the news today. Maddow's show last night came up with a doozy about Paul Manafort and his Russian connections during the campaign. Maybe you'll talk about it on tomorrow's show. I found it very interesting. I'll look into it. A Simpleman. I'll look into it. I mean, like I say, again, that Paul Manafort's connected to the Russians is not necessarily the problem. I mean, look, the Senate Intelligence Committee apparently has the CIA raw intelligence. And it could be because the Senate Intel Committee is, the CIA trusts them more than they do the House. I don't know. I really bought into your point. Dems need to tie Trump to the GOP in the election, and it's still vitally important. We shouldn't call it Trump care. We should call it Republicare. I agree. In fact, I just went through this with somebody on Ring of Fire, actually. Comrade Biden, carbon emissions wouldn't be such a big problem if it weren't for the greenhouse gas effect. Yet another problem we can blame on the real killer, the sun. F attacks. Maybe we need to abolish the sun ASAP. Maybe if the majority report wasn't in the pocket of Big Sun, we'd have a real conversation.
I wish I had thought of that.
I would like to propose a military action against the sun. The sun is a greater terrorist threat than even Al-Qaeda or ISIS. Google it.
Totally in the pocket of Big Sun.
Totally in the pocket. I wish we were.
Hey, Sam.
I think it's only okay that you're doing that gay voice.
It's not a gay voice. That's what he sounds. That is his voice.
I know, but you,
that is his voice.
It's his voice.
Okay.
It's his period. Voice. I mean, that people had this problem with Ted Cruz's dad. They're like, you're doing some ridiculous sounding accent because he's Cuban.
Oh,
no,
they did?
We're doing a ridiculous sounding accent because that's what he sounds like.
You know what might be problematic?
And it's funny because that's what he sounds like.
Yes. And you know what might be problematic?
Too, and it's okay because Peter Thiel is evil.
Well, that's
and he wants to hide that.
But that's a totally specific joke. The premise of that joke is that he bankrupted somebody. And he also sounds quite the opposite. Anyways, I don't want to have to break down all this, but that's how the guy sounds.
That's how
if I did
sounds.
Ted Cruz's voice and I said, I am Ted Cruz, I'm running for the president, that might be a problem.
Exactly. Exactly. If you did that for Marco Rubio,
exactly.
I'd be like, that's not
Yeah, that's a little
funny.
Inappropriate.
You're just taking his last name
exactly.
And that he's...
I'm going, hey, man, Marco Rubio, man. I want to be fucking president.
Right.
That's a problem.
Right.
Oh, kind
but
of funny.
There was nothing gay about what that guy said. It was just dumb.
No, I just think the flamboyance factor is upped. And
he's
I'm just okay
how about
with
we do it like
because
this?
He's...
Hello, governor. How about we tax the sun? I'm talking like this
aerobic.
Because I don't want to be accused of doing his voice in too far away. All right, then.
As far as I know, it's the...
Very
British
interesting.
Accent.
Very interesting. I've noted that
the
no
British
one's mentioned how much the ladies are being taxed for being on their beds.
As far as I know, a British accent isn't as controversial because nobody is persecuting
I have
British
a feeling,
people
I have
in
a feel,
country.
I have a feeling our British listeners would have a big problem with that accent.
Major problem with that accent.
It's piss poor.
I also don't. Yeah, I mean,
I'm not even doing a British accent. I'm doing, Dick Van Dyke in Mary Poppins.
All And I think I believe he's married, the congressman, at any rate, to a woman. But hey, whatever.
See that there? I've got me a wife.
I've got me a wife. Now, people want to look at Google.
People should take a look at Google. Bollocks.
I declare for the funky presidency. I'm Marco Rubio, man.
Hey, Sam. It's my birthday. No need for the horn. But Mike Flynn Jr., well wishes would be nice. I miss that guy.
Happy birthday to Dad! Sessions fucking met with Ambassador. Yeah.
Flynn registered as a lobbyist in Turkey recently.
Dude, Dad, Prime Minister, President Erdogan is going to give us so much fucking energy drinks.
And shout out to my little brother, Steven, who convinced me to listen and become a member. You know him. I am a messenger as MR member. Sometimes he's even pithy. Keep on keeping on. Oh, that's great. We got a whole family. The nuclear negroid. The flaw with this school choice
bullshit.
You know
what that's from, right?
What's that from?
That's what they call the all of the racists in the Trump administration. They photograph the guy who carries the football.
Yeah. Right. The flaw with this school choice bullshit is that there are unlimited supply of good schools. We need to make all schools good, not set up with a dystopian system where only the wealthy and lucky get educated. Indeed.
That's actually kind of the heart of our plan in a certain sense.
Well, Governor, how about you tax education then?
Yeah, this is actually, this is my new Betsy DeVos impression. I don't know what proficiency means.
The media insists on calling the new health care bill Trumpcare, but we should be calling it Republicare, tying it to the party that would inevitably distance themselves from Trump when the going gets tough down the line. Indeed, I agree. Ignatius Riley, I'd like to operate on your ruptured appendix, but the whole point of science is that the questions are always open. I'm not a medicine denier. Dolink, Flynn's serious felonious behavior as he railed against HRC throw-in jail. Get cell ready for him. Working for Turkey during a campaign, see Salon article, Republicans not focused on the long-term, only short-term with most attention, preserving their privilege to the election cycle. We're losing $400 billion annually to tax evasion. That's five times more than the entire SNAP program cost to feed 50 million people.
Yeah, but they want people to evade taxes.
And they're going to cut. They're cutting.
Yeah, that's the whole point. It's a feature, not a bug. But can I just say really quickly, bringing up Turkey is such a good point because, you know, the Russia stuff, there's something there, but it's out. But Flynn literally was essentially a foreign agent of the Turkish government.
Whatever you say, Shillery.
Well, a foreign agent. How about a foreign agent of every government that would pay her?
He may have been done that, but was he on a tarmac?
Hey, let me tell you something. I'm pretty proud of myself that I was the guy that voted for the candidate with the Green New Deal.
Brave-O-Matic. Sam, can you book a guest to explain to us why lottery winners are the primary drivers of healthcare costs? Having trouble finding good info on this huge problem. Call from a 647 area code. Who's this? Where are you calling from?
This is Dunning Krugerrand calling from Toronto.
Hello, Dunning Krugerrand. What's
your real name? So I just I wanted to comment on the Russia thing, the conspiracy mongers, I guess. One thing that I'm not hearing very much of is just, you know, rather than a conspiracy, that there are lots of people in the Trump administration whose interests align with Russia. And for all the talk about price war, the other thing that's not being talked about very much is Saudi Arabia wants to, they want an IPO for Saudi Aramco. So right now, they're interested in keeping the price of oil high so that the valuation is going to be high enough that they'll make money on the IPO. I think it would be wise to pay attention to Rex Tillerson. He's kind of stayed out of the limelight, and he's the one who knows Putin best. And I mean, of all the interests that are surrounding Trump and trying to push through their agenda, I think the best place is the oil industry. And the oil industry is completely dependent on the state, right? Like, I mean, without their ability to, get access to public lands and you know, externalize their costs, they're dead in the water. I mean, especially with the cost of renewables dropping as fast as they are. I think Saudi Arabia actually, or at least some parts of the Saudi royal family, see the writing on the wall. That's why they're trying to invest in solar, and
that's
why they're trying to sell off Saudi Aramco. I mean, you know, but why would they be trying to sell off Saudi Aramco?
Can I ask you a question, though? I mean, mm-hmm. I think you're right, but I also think that there's a couple different ways of interpreting how Tillerson's going, because on the other hand, I mean, at some point, relentlessly attacking the State Department does actually affect his ability just because that's what his office is to do his job. So I don't know whether he's, I mean, he could also just be being cut out of the loop to a certain extent. It doesn't mean that they don't have a pro-oil agenda regardless, but I don't know. He hasn't had a single one-on-one meeting with Trump, apparently, since he's been in there. And he's clearly not part of that inner circle. And he's out of step with these people because he is actually a relatively, I mean, he's an intelligent and competent guy. He's a terrible guy, but he's not like the normal people in this administration, by which I mean deranged people.
But, you know, it's so hard to, let me just rebut that on some level.
It's just
so
a question.
No. It's fair, and it's a correct assessment. But it's so hard to know if they're not saying, like, look, you just go do that. Because Rex Tillerson doesn't show up at the White House, guess what also doesn't happen? Nobody reports on what he's doing.
Right.
And
that's right.
You know, I imagine the one thing that Rex Tillerson is well-versed in is how to lay low.
And incidentally, one of the first, the oil bribe executive order is something that Tillerson personally lobbied against. So arguably some of the most substantive things that have happened so far in this administration are to his agenda. So, you know, fair enough. Yeah.
The other thing that I think is worth mentioning is that saber rattling against Iran also supports this agenda. Iran is a very low marginal cost producer of oil, almost as low as Saudi Arabia. And if they can ramp up production, it'll really hurt the U.S. oil industry. It'll really hurt Russia. And it'll hurt Saudi Arabia's hopes to float an IPO for Saudi Aramco. So it's definitely in their interest also to make lots of angry noise about Iran.
Interesting.
That's
I appreciate
really
the call. Really interesting insights.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Have a good one.
You too. I mean, I feel like maybe we, Dan Dickerson.
Yeah, have someone like that on again. Maybe Michael Clare. Be interesting to see what he says about this stuff, too.
Who's Michael Clare?
Oh, he wrote Resource Wars.
Oh, right. You're talking about that guy. Getting hung up here on the phone. Let's go. Oh, let's play this. This is really heartwarming. At a, on a day, actually, I guess, Fox, to celebrate International Women's Day, my understanding is, and they were just wrapping up plans to provide a settlement with another woman who had been sexually assaulted and harassed at Fox News. And meanwhile, her former colleagues, maybe they were never contemporaneous, were on The Five Tuesday. And here is Meghan McCain, the daughter of the man who gave us Sarah Palin, on Fox News. Now, I don't want to define Meghan McCain in any way through her father.
Really?
Except for the fact that no one I know or you know or anybody in the sound of my voice or if my voice could travel through buildings in like miles from here would know who Meghan McCain was were it not for her dad.
That is correct.
Here she is on The Five.
All right, Kimberly, I am going to start with you just because we're both the women on the show. Both of us decided to show up today. I already spoke at length on this on Outnumbered. I co-host a show that is female dominated. Mm-hmm. I feel empowered every day. And the fact that I'm on a show where the male voices aren't as significant as the
except
female voices.
Today.
Except for when you two are the one lucky guys. Oh, in numbers
exactly.
As well. It's unusual in news for women to outnumber men on panels. I find value in showing up at work. Beyond that, they just said coming out of their mouths, this is an anti-Trump protest, mm-hmm. an anti-conservative protest, and there are no Republican people, women that I can see
pause
involved
it for
in
one
these
moment.
Protests.
Now, Meghan McCain may not be aware of this, but the vast majority, I think it's safe to say, the vast majority of women in the workforce do not work on a TV show that is hosted by a majority of women. In fact, to be fair, I don't have the data on this, but I would say the vast majority of women in the workforce don't work on any TV show.
Why did you choose to show up today to work?
Yeah, you know, I echo your sentiment. I thank God every day that I have a job and I'm able to work here at Fox News. I'm able to sit at the table with smart, intelligent people who are passionate about what they do and they appreciate the jobs that they have. As women, we're in a powerful position and we choose to own it and live it and breathe it every day. By me sitting here, by you sitting here, by the women outnumbered and our colleagues, that is making a strong statement and a statement out there to young women that can look up to us to say they can grow up to become and do anything that they think about and believe in their hopes and dreams. Get a good education, get a great job. I want to celebrate all the advances that women have been able to achieve in this country and hold ourselves up as an example to other countries around the world where women are oppressed.
What?
So the best way to do that is by being here.
Hey, now, Kimberly, it's Roger.
Here's the best part about Kim Guilfoyle just said. She thinks that women are doing great in this country because she is.
That's Republican
logic. It is
always
so stunning. Like the lack of self-awareness. I want to show my solidarity with all the women who will not actually hear or see me. In other words, I'm here representing how well I'm doing to help women in foreign countries, read Muslim, who don't have the opportunities that I have. That's basically where she was going with that.
If you had to see and do the things that perhaps she had to see and do, you might have a little bit more sympathy for her, Sam.
I'm not saying that she should have stayed home from work or whatnot. I mean, frankly, good for her. I imagine that the workplace there is a lot less terrifying.
I would imagine it's an extra relief to not have him around during International Women's Day.
Exactly.
It's International Women's Day. I think we all know what that means.
I'd like to empower you.
I'd like to empower all of you.
I just like to note that she is, I think she's like 50 years old. Guilfoyle, yeah. Pretty sure.
Well, Allahu Akbar.
Okay.
No, I mean, apparently she just looks really good. I don't know. It's crazy.
50 Puerto Rico, PRs, they sure do age well.
Bob Beckel, I think, is like 103.
Bob Beckel's awesome. I'm sorry. Can
like
we just come out and
come
back?
They only gave Meghan McCain and Kimberly Guilfoyle the room to actually speak full sentences and what they wanted to say because
it was international.
Well, and she's like, it's rare.
As soon as they got an opening, they talked over Meghan McCain and she had to like both of her hands to, you know,
can we be
off.
Fair
physically
that even when
them.
Meghan McCain is given an opportunity to speak in full sentences, she doesn't.
Okay, look, the two people that she was putting her hands up to are idiots too.
Well, and the funny thing about
I
is like they're talking about
regularly.
Meghan McCain talking about outnumbered and how it's so impressive that there are more women on that show than men, and that's the whole premise
she
of that show. That's the whole premise of the show.
Empowered by it, Matt, which I'm sure she does. Because people don't constantly talk over her, but also maybe
you
people talk over
Matt.
Her because
you just talked over.
Yeah,
Matt.
I did because I didn't do anything for International Women's Day, and that was what I'm doing.
This
because
is how
Matt's,
you're empowering yourself.
Matt's my oppressor here.
Meghan McCain.
Speaking of oppressors,
yeah, she's had an extraordinarily lucky life.
Who's that, Meghan McCain?
Yeah,
honestly,
she's kind of a walking insult to anybody who's had to work for anything.
I mean, it is pretty impressive how how little solidarity. Well, it's not. I mean,
she is peak white feminism. I mean, as a very specific critique, we were talking about this on, with a sociologist from Hunter College on Dope Boys. I mean, the idea that Meghan McCain could symbolize anything for anyone that isn't, I don't know, another white trust fund baby who got handed a cable job.
I mean, to be fair, we don't know if she has a trust fund. She's grown up as a millionaire, as the daughter of a millionaire.
Okay, fair enough.
But for all we know, she doesn't need a trust fund. Maybe they, maybe she has some type of, maybe, you know, I don't know, like a building.
Yeah.
She's getting rents.
Maybe she has several buildings.
And
her internship at Fox is subsidized.
Speaking of
now.
Trust fund babies, Tucker Carlson again on Fox. Is it what is it what is he his family?
Is it like is it like was it the Dove or some type
I feel
of
like some major
like ice cream company
yeah,
or
something
like
that.
It looks like something that it looks like he would come from. Soft and pudgifying.
Here's Tucker Carlson taking issue.
Ice cream cakes.
Well, is
Kelly
it?
Says, yeah.
I don't know. Here's Tucker Carlson taking issue with Jorge Ramos. Why? Because Jorge Ramos tries to pass as not white.
So at an event several weeks ago in February, you said this, and I wanted to ask you about it, and I'm quoting you. I'm a proud Latino immigrant here in the United States. You know exactly what is going on here in the U.S. There are many people who do not want us to be here and who want to create a wall in order to separate us. But you know what? This is also our country. Let me repeat this. Our country, not theirs. It's our country.
Pause it. Who's the us? Now, Tucker Carlson is going to spend this entire interview thinking he's got a huge gotcha. He's got his, what was it, the La Raza? Or whatever it is,
right.
he's gonna blow the lid off this whole story about how Jorge Ramos, you know, wants to take over the country. Watch how this goes. It's pretty funny.
Our country. Let me repeat this: our country, not theirs. It's our country. Who's the us and who's the they? Whose country is it?
This is our country. It is yours. It is mine, and it is ours. The interesting thing is that. With the Trump administration and many people who support Donald Trump, they think it is their country, that it is a white country, and they are absolutely wrong. This is not a white country. This is not their country. It is ours, and that's precisely what I'm saying. Look, in 2044, country, the white population will become a minority. It will be a minority-majority country. That's precisely what I'm saying. Latinos, Asians, African Americans, whites, it is our country, Tucker.
Right. Yeah. Well, let me just point out that you are white, obviously. You're whiter than I am. You've got blue eyes. So, I mean, I don't know exactly what you mean by white or Latino, but let me just ask you again to explain our country, not theirs. Who is they? Whose country is it not?
Well, many people who want to go back to 1965 when there was a white majority. Many people who believe that Latinos and immigrants and refugees shouldn't be here. That's precisely what I was referring to.
So it's not their country?
Before the election,
it doesn't belong to those people? What are you saying?
Well, it's also their country, but it's not only their country.
Right.
We have to understand that this is a multicultural, multiracial country.
That's it. Oh, okay. Oh, that whole project that I had about trying to exclude them. Oh, you were just, it was just the way that you were really saying not exclusively theirs, and it was just understood. And the whole premise of this this booking just fell apart. Damn it!
Tucker reveals that he can't accept being lumped in with our when Jorge Ramos says our. Tucker Carlson automatically assumes that excludes him.
Right. Let me think here. You got blue eyes. Whiter than me.
Whiter than I.
Segment is going off.
Heir to the Swanson frozen food fortune.
Actually, it would be great.
It is.
It would be great. Yeah, it is. Yeah. It would be great if Jorge Ramos just went and it's almost like the news equivalent of the Obama conspiracy theories. Like if he was just like, we will destroy the pale-faced and there will be a great Aztec resurrection.
Exactly.
What are you talking about?
That reminds me of his full first name, which is Tucker Swanson McNear Carlson.
Wow. Anybody like
Tucker,
that?
What is it?
Tucker Swanson McNear Carlson.
And you know what I have to say about Tucker Carlson, and I don't know why I say this, because he's totally loathsome, but he went with Al Sharpton several years ago on a peace mission to Liberia, although I think they ended up in Ghana and they didn't get to Liberia. And his column that he wrote of hanging out with Al Sharpton and Cornel West and some Nation of Islam ministers for a week, like, I mean, he's a complete dick. It's not like you read it and you say, oh, Tucker Carlson's kind of a good guy. But it was actually very funny. Apparently he could write at a certain point.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Then I think he realized, like, I got to make some cash. Vegas right. Fire. I work as a paramedic, and there are certain protocols that are mandated to transport people to certain hospitals, regardless of where the patient wants to go. And to insurance is not even in the equation. For example, chest pain, go to chest pain centers. Traumas, go to trauma centers, etc. 25 years, I never called the hospital to see if they're having a sale on x-rays, limiting insurance and reducing the ability of patients to go see their doctor and ER becomes their personal physician, spills into 9/11 emergency calls. Not to mention makes the ER busier and takes up a bed for real serious medical emergencies. Walt Chamberlain, wondering what your thoughts are on Taibbi's new piece about the left overplaying, overhyping the Russia card. I've pulled that, but I haven't seen, I haven't read it.
Where I would recommend Masha Gessen's on that.
Where is the balance between, yeah, we're trying to get her on the program. I've been trying for a long time. The Greenwalds who seem to think any criticism of Russia is akin to a new Cold War, and the shitty liberals who think Russia is behind all the failures of the Democratic Party.
Yes.
Seems like I'm fine line walk to walk and feel stuck in the middle somewhere. Well, I mean, that to me is a big seam, right? Because we have talked about the Trump administration relationship with Russia without ever attributing the hack to Hillary Clinton's, or attributing Hillary Clinton's loss to the DNC emails.
Yeah, the Russians didn't tell her to, like, deploy Lena Dunham.
Well, but neither. James Comey didn't tell her to deploy Lena Dunham either.
No,
but I
he
actually
did not.
Think that had James Comey's letter effect. is more of a proximate cause. I think there's about a half dozen. I think the emails are so far down on the list that that you can't really it's not significant, frankly. It's just so far down the list of the things that were determinant of her loss, ranging from Comey to other strategic mistakes her campaign made. But I think it's like I've said, if it was the Saudis they all had relationships with, like, you know, we talked about this with Trump. I mean, with Bush.
Right.
And if there was, like, even more evidence that George Bush was radically changing American foreign policy. I mean, at least in that administration, there were people that you could imagine, like, oh, they do have, like, a policy agenda. I would disagree with it, but they do have one. I'm sorry. I don't believe that Donald Trump contemplated the idea of, like, we've got to change the New World Order here. And I believe there is some type of relationship there that is, and I don't think it's particularly, I don't know what a new, what would a new Cold War look like?
I mean, frankly, it would look relatively proximate to what's already been happening the past several years. If you want to use that terminology, we're already there.
I'm saying, like, are people afraid that if, Donald Trump is found to have a relationship with Russia that because of the banks or whatever it is, PP on his face or whatever it is, that we're going to move to expand NATO? Like, I'm just
right.
Like, you know, right. Like, is somebody, I can't even remember who I was having this argument with, was saying, like, this is just so that, you know, the arms manufacturers can get more money. Donald Trump just proposed $65 billion more in military spending annually. Like,
my wife would have doubled that.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, what would a new Cold War with Russia look like?
Yeah, it's delusional. And actually, and incidentally, not only the other really disturbing part of it is that what some of these people want, and I agree, I don't want us to have unnecessary conflict with Russia at all either, but, like, the plan that people like Mike Flynn had was, we should coordinate with Russia more
to kill more people in places like the Middle East.
Yes.
Like, so you're talking about arms manufacturers, war and civilian casualties. That's what they're talking about. They're not talking about going to Reykjavik and having an arms control deal. They're talking about, and Putin said even before September 11th, that he's fighting radical Muslim terrorists and that America doesn't get it and we have the same interests. So no one is bigger and more. That's the whole war in Chechnya is against Muslim terrorists. And, you know, the amount of civilians that have been killed there is astronomical. So that's what they're talking about.
I mean, I think it's important for us to have to maintain good relationships with Russia because they have so many nukes and we want to help them lock those down. And I do think that we have expanded NATO beyond where we, and we missed a big opportunity 15, 20 years ago.
And we screwed them in the 90s.
I just don't understand what it is that people are concerned is going to happen. You can just say a new Cold War, but what does that mean?
And we screwed them in the 90s with the shock doctrine.
Right. What is that? I just don't even know what that means.
It doesn't mean anything. And actually, for what it's worth, I mean, Obama actually did a pretty decent job of balancing these things.
Yes. And I think there's an argument that Hillary was going to take a more
she would be
confrontational
a
position on it. But yeah, okay, I agree. The meaning of insurance in these sticks. Insurance is a contract represented by a policy in which an individual entity receives financial protection or reimbursement against losses from an insurance company. The company pools clients' risks to make payments more affordable for the insured. I work for a state regulator. I have been in this industry for 20 years. Paul Ryan is a dipshit. Bull Prague. Republicans give ISPs ability to sell user data, and WikiLeaks hands out CIA tools to tech companies to fix vulnerabilities, So we don't care if corporations effectively spy on us and the feds lose way to track extremists, child porn traffickers, and black market operators, priorities. Cherish. It's truly nice to hear Sam getting urgent and direct about the failure of opposition by the Democratic Party. Opposition to Trump Care, Pruitt, fellow agency workers, and of course, opposition to Trump's election itself by a party that still fears progressive messages and shuns progressive leaders. Because this party will surely fail to oppose the re-election of Trump if we do not, if we, not the dumb, dumb left, don't figure out the critiques and activism that will bring about the only party that can stem the bleeding in 2018, 2020, and beyond. Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of, you know, entities that brand themselves as supporters of the Democratic Party that are doing this. I mean, you know, the Daily Kos, which I think is, in a broadly speaking, been more partisan than I have been over the past 8 years, let's say, they've also raised, I don't know, $1 million more for this race in Georgia, which I think is really important. And I think they push better, stronger messaging than we see out of, let's say, Schumer. I mean,
oh,
so there's different entities doing that.
I'm doing lots of messaging, you schmuckle.
Chris Lopaco, I talked to Doug the other day, and he wants to be part of the MR family again. He says he wants to be allowed to chat in the chat room, but Matt banned him. Let him come back temporarily and ban him again. Matt, did you ban Doug?
I had forgotten that I did, but I think I did.
Well, we do have that thing where you can donate to the show via the chat. Don't we still have that super chat?
Yeah, but I don't know if you can do that if you're already banned.
Yeah, you can't buy your way back into the chat.
Well, that's exactly
saying,
what you can do. I would say if you
I'm
give us money, you can say whatever you want.
I'm saying for someone like Doug.
Of course.
Who feels so strongly about the free market.
Yeah.
I think it would be interesting to see how much is it worth it to him.
It would be incredibly interesting if Doug ever gave us
any money. Curious. I'd be curious to see how much it would be worth.
Maybe if you got rid of these illegals winning lotteries, taking my VA hospital bills, because yes, Guatemalans who were never even in the military get to go to the VA because of Obama, I'd have money to contribute to the super chat.
The DX will.
The way I remember
hello?
It, he was banned and I reinstated him. I think. That was a long time ago.
Hello, as I tried to tell you before you actually turned on the IM machine, the Affordable Care Act does tax tanning beds, while Hawaii has a general excise tax of at least 4% that covers everything, including food and drugs. Also, Do you know if Betsy DeVos's brother, Eric Prince, is advising Trump's security force? He has been an advisor to him, and I would imagine those are the type of things they talk about. Colin Doucette, read a Massachusetts accent. Wolf, to stop the sexual assault of wildlings crossing the wall to escape the White Walkers, we will flay their men alive, feed their women and their babies to feral dogs to dissuade them from making the journey. Because I detest sexual assault, dude.
Dude, you can say a lot of things about me as Ramsey Bolton and whatnot, but I am very opposed to sexual violence in any way, shape, or form.
That little kid who thinks he's like an eagle or something, or a crow? I mean, give me a break.
We need to figure out what the hell's going on with that.
We totally need to figure out. The guy's like, I can't tell. Is he blind? Or he just has weird eyes?
He can't walk, but now he's going to fly?
It's and then like, sometimes he's walking around. It doesn't make any sense,
is
right?
He, is
and
he
what a, about ho-dee-do, ho-dee-do? What about that guy?
I don't think he's documented.
Ben in Detroit. Oh, my God. I tweeted Squawk Box constantly about how much it sucks. I wonder how much CNBC pays Joe Kernan to play with crayons and coloring books every morning. I listen to Squawk Box every morning because when I drive to work, because I have a passive interest in the market, but more importantly, because the rage that is induced by listening to Joe Kernan wakes me up faster than the strongest cup of coffee. R.L. Garner, anyone interested in further fascism discussion should check out Slate's recent podcast series entitled Fascism. It's very informative with great experts and guests. Very eerie, too. Oh, well, all right. Great. Unorthodox, AMR crew, I recently read George Lakoff's The Political Mind and highly suggest for anyone who wants to hear better market progressive ideas. This book turned my fascist boyfriend into a progressive Democrat because he realized that his strict father upbringing impacted all his political theories. Recently signed up for my local Democratic chapter, and my boyfriend is an intern at the New York City Council. Get out there, progressive, but first read Lakoff. It'll change the way you think. Majority support. Why doesn't the Trump administration use the phrase isolated incident more? Deuce wrestled my brother over Medicare and won. Shofar. Okay. All right. I got to go. So let's see what we got here. I got time for one more call. Sorry. I know I got people who have been on the phone for some instances over an hour and a half. I'm sorry, folks. I only got time for one more. It doesn't even seem to be. Calling from an 818 area code. Who's this?
Hey, Sam, this is Steve in Washington. Thanks for taking my call.
Thanks for holding for so long, Steve. What's on your mind?
The interview this morning was fantastic. I was really glad you were doing that because hearing that new information, despite all the Trump stuff that's going on, is good. Two quick points, and I'll be quick since you got to go. One, I think when the GOP talks about school choice, I think they mean choice for themselves, not to have their tax dollars going to poor people or brown people.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's all it means.
That's right.
And then the other is when they talk about the purpose and the point of education, and you kind of talked about that this morning as well. Something I always get frustrated with, and I'm an educator, is they talk about education as a way for students to be ready for the economy, for the 21st century economy, not for the actual education itself, but actually so they'll make good workers, so they'll make good employees. And I even hear people on the left saying that, and I get really frustrated when I hear that, and I'm not really sure how to counter that or what to say to that, but it's something I struggle with. And but it was a great interview, and I wanted to thank you for that.
So. Oh, my pleasure. No, I'm with you on that. It is really aggravating to hear people talk about getting an education as if it is like as if basic fundamental education should be a vocational school. You know what I mean? I got nothing against vocational schools. Frankly, I think I am probably if I had to do it over again, I might have more carpentry skills and some plumbing. But the point is that we need a fundamental K through 12 education to create thoughtful, intelligent, questioning citizens. and
critical thinkers.
Critical thinkers, exactly. And the idea that everything should be geared towards being a member of the 21st century workforce is nauseating and like dystopic in a way, right? Like, but I appreciate the phone call.
Thank you so much.
All right, folks, that's all I got for the phones. We'll take a couple more IMs. Okay. Matt.
B.
B, indeed. Be silly. Sam, your insight about different values with respect to education can be extended to all contemporary politics. It seems we have one party in a paradigm where you earnestly argue ideas that it thinks it's better the lives of its constituents, and another party in a paradigm where you implement tactics to consolidate power. It's the failure to see this dynamic clearly that's been partly the downfall of the Democratic Party, and a failure of the media. Pointing out hypocrisy in Republican Party is meaningless. Indeed, I agree. Kelly.
G-M-J.
Georgia Republicans are shook. They are trying to redraw districts. Will the DNC do about this? Don't know. Michael.
H.
Hugo Ball. I went to Avon Old Farms, which was next door to Trinity, and bing, 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 it was a hockey feeder school that produced Brian Leetch of New York Rangers fame. Thank you.
Yeah, no, I agree. They cucked you, or they would have if you went there.
Aye. Oddly enough.
That's interesting.
No eyes.
J.
Well, J. No J. Give me one more. Don't strike out again, buddy.
N.
Should be a low-hanging fruit. But.
It isn't.
Dude, you lose.
We're just going to go. See.
I'm just going to go with Paul Jizz. The way to get Trump to back away from Republicare to convince him the fight and subsequent failure would make Obama into a bigger hero. I think you're right. Convince this whole thing is about humiliation at the White House correspondence dinner a few years back. Kelly.
S.
Sam, I am. Sam Harris was right. He said if liberals can't speak intelligently about radical Islam, then the fascists would win. If liberals just admitted the reality of radical Islam, then we wouldn't have Trump today. Obama said ISIS isn't Islamic. Come on. How did that help? Now we got Brexit, Angela Merkel losing, Marine Le Pen, Britain first. Don't you see the rise of fascism? Give the guy credit, yo.
This guy sent this to me on Tuesday.
Is this a joke?
I don't know whether it's a joke or the stupidest listener we have. I honestly don't know.
I think it's a parody. Michael.
F.
Film Fest guy. Any chance the April 8th show at the Bell House will be on your Facebook Live or YouTube?
No.
Kelly?
Excuse me?
Is the April 8th show going to be on Facebook Live or YouTube?
I will not be answering that question as of right now.
There you go.
You should buy tickets to the show if you can make
it. If you want to see it.
And otherwise, I'll let you know approximately immediately.
One more round. Matt.
K.
K. Everybody gets so goddamn clever, but then you struck out again, dude.
I thought that was a basic one.
Fail.
C.
Christo. Tucker Carlson, Swanson Foods. Kelly, one more. Come on. Guys, let's pick up the pace here.
Just win.
Yeah, you'll get two. Well, there's no winning. You'll get two. I'll give you three
Jay,
guesses.
Since everyone's
that is a bad one. I can't believe you took all the time. Jimmy D. Love your analysis and reliable breakdown of the feeble Democrats. Their spine is buried in corporate ties and money. I'm sick of it. Medicare for all should be the Democratic rallying cry, and even takes jabs at Stupid Spicer for comparing stacks of paper. Oh, yeah, look at how effing tiny our stack is, Sean. Three words.
And there's no lottery in it.
Michael.
Hey. Sorry. Jerk.
Aaron, if Russia wants to drop million-dollar bombs on the sun, I think that's great. Russia's big league. They want to fight the sun. And then I say, batter up. And the final I am of the day. Denver Dave. Blowing a shofar is Roger Stone's best swinger move. It's not surprising that school choice proponents who are in the recipients of subsidies in the form of school coupons produce children who think democracy is a bad idea. Conservatives are right. Voting with our dollars works, especially when they use other dollars to vote for choice. See you tomorrow. It might take all the strength I got to get to where I want, but I know somehow I'm gonna get there. I wasn't looking when I just got caught between the truth and the light bulb. But finding out won't make me feel any better. Yeah, I know the clock is ticking, but the meds are gonna kick in, and my pilot somewhere the choice was made, for the option where you don't get paid, for the road that bends before it finally breaks you. I guess somehow I lost my drive between the 101 and the 5. Do you know how far the detour takes?